I'm going to present my talk on the topic Wu experiment, which proved the non-conservation of parity in weak interactions. The contents of the talk will be: what is parity, parity invariance, a fundamental question, conservation in interactions, tau theta puzzle, hypothesis, experiment, result, neutrino behavior, and references. Okay, so basically, what is parity? The parity transformation is a mathematical operation that flips the sign of the coordinate axis. That is, if we apply this operation, then the physical quantities that we measure and the quantities that we are concerned with change in such a manner that the coordinate system goes from a right-handed system to a left-handed system. Like if I apply, if I apply parity twice, then I would get back to the same object. That is, the parity operator has the eigenvalues plus and minus one. And in this sense, thinking about this, we can talk about reflections. So that in a mirror, our left hand becomes our right hand and vice versa, because what parity does is only changing from a left-handed system to a right-handed system. So it is exactly the same as a reflection in a mirror. But a word of caution, that a parity transformation in principle is a reflection after which an inversion is carried out. But this is in three dimensions. If we confine ourselves to only one dimension, then we can only talk about reflection. Such that if I point my thumb towards the mirror and call it positive z-axis, then in the mirror my thumb would be pointing the negative z-direction, because the other two axes we are not concerned with right now, and this is very simple so that we can understand the argument more simply. Now what we are concerned with today is how scalars and vectors transform under this operation. So a scalar goes from S to S, as I've written in the table which I've taken from Griffiths. A pseudo scalar goes from K to minus K. A polar vector goes from V to minus V. And an axial vector goes from A to A. We have all studied these vectors, so I don't think there's a need to tell about these vectors more. But one thing that we have to be concerned about in this talk, and I want everyone to keep in mind, that one of the very important examples of an axial vector is the orbital angular momentum. Like, because L is equal to R cross P, and R and P both change signs under parity. So L does not change under parity. And since spin is also an angular momentum itself, so spin also does not change its sign under parity. It is also an axial vector. Parity invariance. What is parity invariance? It means that the laws of physics are indifferent to left and right handedness. To understand this more intuitively, imagine a mirror were held up to our universe, and in the mirror, the z-direction is reversed, so that our right hand becomes our left hand and vice versa. But the important thing is that the physics laws should not care about how we have defined our left or our right. They should work exactly in the same way in the mirror world as they would do in a normal regular one, with no preference for left and right. This means that there should not be any experiment that we can devise that would tell you whether you're in the real world or in the mirror world. Quoting Feynman, he's written in his book that if the laws of physics are symmetrical, we should find that if some demon were to sneak into all the physics laboratories and replace the word left for right in every book in which right-hand rules are given, and instead we were to use left-hand rules uniformly all over the world so that the convention is followed for everybody and not just in some part of the world, then it should make no difference whatsoever in the physical laws. And here I've shown two images in which there's this triangle which under parity does not change. So it is parity symmetric. And this figure, which if I view in the mirror, it is parity asymmetric. That is, it changes its shape in a mirror. So the fundamental question that we are concerned with is, does our universe have a sense of direction? And can it tell a left-handed system from a right-handed one? But more importantly, as physicists, we pondered upon the question that do physics laws have a sense of direction? can physics law distinguish between a left-handed system or a right-handed one? Now, thinking about this, up until the 1950s, everybody assumed, because this is something very intuitive, okay, so everybody assumed that the natural answer to this question would be physics laws do not care about interactions do conserve this parity operation. The interactions which actually do conserve this operation are electromagnetic and strong, and the interaction which does not conserve this operation is weak. But really, how did we get to know about this is the question. So the question came from this tau theta person. So in the 1950s, there were two strange mesons which were called at the time theta and tau. And these two mesons appear to be identical in almost every aspect. They had the same mass, they had the same spin, they had the same charge, they had the same lifetime. Almost everything was the same, except that they decayed into that their decay modes were very different. If you see the upper reaction, where theta plus is going to pi plus and pi zero, we already know from our nuclear physics course that parity is multiplicative, and also the parity of pions is negative. So for the upper reaction, I have minus 1 into minus 1. I mean, multiplying the parities of the final particles makes the final parity as plus 1. And in the lower reaction, we have tau plus going to 3 pions, which would make the parities minus 1 into minus 1 into minus 1 as minus 1. So tau plus has negative. So in principle, if parity is conserved in these reactions, then theta plus has parity plus 1 and tau plus has parity minus 1. So the puzzle was that how can two identical particles carry different parities, because they're the same, like they look like the same particles, right? They have everything the same, but then why do they decay why do they decay through different modes? So that was the puzzle that had us wondering for a very long time. So an alternative was suggested that parity is actually not conserved in these type of reactions. Hypothesis. So Li and Yang predicted the non-conservation of parity in the weak interaction. This came about because they were studying this exact tau theta puzzle, and they looked through the literature. And they found that there was ample evidence for parity conservation in strong as well as electromagnetic processes. Like there had been experiments devised to check the parity violation in electromagnetic and strong, but there was no strong evidence that would support this claim that parity is conserved in weak interaction or refute this claim. Like experiments were not devised for this kind of thing. So they suggested, because of this tau theta puzzle, they thought that maybe it is that the parity is not conserved. So they devised experiments to study this thing, to prove, to get to know that whether parity is actually conserved or not. So one of the experiments was the beta decay of oriented nuclei, where I've given the general reaction of a beta minus decay, where a parent nucleus of A and Z goes to a daughter nucleus and emits electron and antineutrino. So what was the experiment? They actually went to Madame Wu, who was a Chinese American physicist, experimental physicist, and she had a master's in beta spectroscopy. So they went to her to ask her to devise an experiment that would confirm their hypothesis. So Wu and a team of low temperature scientists cooled a collection of cobalt-60 nuclei to 0.003 Kelvin, and then they applied a magnetic field such that they applied the nuclear spins of all the cobalt nuclei in a specific direction, which was the magnetic field itself, and we can take it for our convenience to be the positive Z axis. Now, cobalt-60 is radioactive and it decays via weak force, releasing an electron and antineutrino. The experiment measured the direction of the emitted electrons. to see how this works under, and I've given the reaction here where cobalt goes to nickel, electron and antineutrino. To see how this works under parity symmetry, consider the mirror version of this experiment where the z-axis is flipped but the direction of spin of nucleus is not. This is because we've already studied that axial vectors like the spin does not change under parity. So in the mirror world and in the real world, these spins are, the experiment is actually the same. So if I see the decay of electron, there should be 50% probability of electron going in either direction. Okay, so if parity is invariant, then the electron is equally likely to go in either direction. That way, both real and mirror image experiments give us the same results. However, if electrons were emitted in the same direction, in say positive z-axis, then in mirror, electrons would have to go in negative z-direction because we know that momentum flips sign under parity. So in normal world, if they are emitted, say, in a direction opposite to the nucleus, they would be emitted in the actually distinct between world and our regular world. So this excerpt I've taken from Madame Boo's original paper, in which she says that if an asymmetry in the distribution is observed, then it provides proof that parity is actually not conserved. It is, and this asymmetry effect has been observed. So the result was that more electrons were actually emitted in the direction opposite to the nuclear spin, which tells us that parity is not conserved because this reaction would appear to be different in the mirror version of the world. Now the question is, why does this actually happen? So for that we need to define a very important quantity, which is helicity. So H is the projection of spin along the direction of motion. And if I take the direction of motion as z-axis, then H is equal to ms upon s. Now for fermions, S is half. So if I take ms is equal to half, then H is 1. And if I take ms is equal to minus half, then H is equal to minus 1. Now, helicity happens in... I will explain this. But let's move ahead. So in the reaction which was performed, in the reaction which is given, this... we know that spin angular momenta is always conserved, and taking the orbital angular momentum to be zero because nickel has very small, like it has a very large mass, so the velocity would be very less, and electron and antineutrino are already emitted very close to the nucleus, so L is zero, so spin has to be conserved. Now cobalt has spin 5, nickel has spin 4, so to conserve spin, electron and antineutrino have to be emitted with the spins aligned in the same direction, so that 4 plus half gives us 5. Okay, so now their spins are aligned in the same direction. So if parity was actually conserved, then we would get antineutrinos in the left also and in the right also. And similarly, we would get electrons in the left also and in the right also, because we have to conserve linear momentum also. And considering that nickel is very large and its velocity is very small as compared to these, we can say that electron and antineutrino are almost emitted in the opposite directions. Now if parity, I'm repeating my point to make it clearer. If parity is conserved, then electron would go to the right and with equal probability of it going to the left. Similarly, an antineutrino would go to the right and it would go to the left. But it has been experimentally observed that in nature, only right-handed antineutrinos are formed. Meaning, antineutrinos can, if they have the spin aligned in the positive z-direction, they can only travel in the positive z-direction. And hence, parity cannot be conserved because in the mirror world, they would actually become left-handed because spin would not change, but our angle, but our linear momentum would change because that is a polar vector. And discovery leads 30 seconds.
Okay.
ली एंड यांग गॉट दी नोबेल प्राइज इन 1957 फॉर दिस डिस्कवरी, एंड वू डिड वॉज ओनली मेंशन इन द नोबेल प्राइज एक्सेप्टेंस स्पीच, एंड शी वॉज नॉट ऑनर्ड अंटिल 1978 व्हेन शी वॉज अवॉर्डेड द फर्स्ट वुल्फ प्राइज. दिस डिस्क्रिमिनेशन वॉज रिकग्नाइज बाय अ लॉट ऑफ साइंटिस्ट ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, एंड दे स्टिल फील दैट वू शुड हैव गॉटन द नोबेल प्राइज because this was not an easy experiment to be performed. I have not given the details because it's a very small talk, but if you actually read about it, then the technology that they had in 1950s could not, I mean, it would not have been easy for her team to actually perform this experiment. And she has, who was a strong feminist, and she said that there is only one thing worse than coming home from the lab to a sink full of dirty dishes, and that is not going to the lab at all. So here are the references, and thank you.